Black characters on the screen has changed a lot during the years, from the beginning to where we are now in 2022 as I'm writing this. The history of cinema offers us a broad and complex collection of different portrayals of black characters and stories from both black directors but also from other perspectives. And I want to be clear, when I talk about black characters, I'm specifically referring to Afro-Americans. This is not a video essay on African cinema. This will specifically talk about a certain portrayal of American cinema and its portrayal of black Americans. I also want to point out and narrow it down more. This video essay couldn't even begin to talk about black portrayal in American cinema as a broad statement. It's impossible to do that with such a small scale that I'm working with. I want to hone in on a specific time period, the 70s, in its portrayal of black people. There was a lot of stuff going on inside of this time period, as I will go more into later, but I also want to fetch black portrayals from far back, since the beginning of the 1900s. All of this will convalesce into one movie of the decade. The movie I'm talking about is the infamous Coonskin by Ralph Bakshi. This is a pretty controversial movie, and Coonskin is a satire that plays on racist iconography from different time periods in American cinema. It looks at the blaxploitation of the 70s, it looks at the Disney movie Song of the South from the 40s, and it uses a lot of the racist caricatures from the even earlier days to deliver its message. This is one of the earliest examples I could find of this type of movie. You could mention Putney Swope and Watermelon Man as predecessors to Coonskin, but because the other movies weren't criticized to the same levels that Bakshi's movie was, I find his more interesting to examine together with the extreme caricatures he uses. So what I want to analyze in this video essay is how Bakshi uses the racist iconography in Coonskin. Major text that I have been using is Donald Bogle's Toms, Coons, Mulattoes, Mammies, and Bucks, an interpretative history of blacks in American films. I've gathered all of my information on racial iconography and the different time periods in American cinema from this source. Disney's most notorious film, Race, Convergence, and the Hidden Histories of Song of the South, and Contemporary Black Cinema, Race, Gender, and Sexuality at the Movies. These three basically forms the big part of my understanding for this video essay. The theoretical ramification, which I will apply on the movie, is a combination between Bogle's book and contemporary black cinema, which offers both a description of the old racial iconography, but also newer ones, and a perspective on blackness in visuality and what the black skin can mean on different levels. I also want to point out Ella Showett and Robert Stamm's book, Unthinking Eurocentrism, Multiculturalism, and Media. While this is not a major text that I've used, I think it's important to highlight that I have been reading this a little bit, and there are a lot of interesting discussions inside of this that has probably inspired what I've been looking at and how. What's the connection from Coonskin to where we are today? Jordan Peele is one of the most successful black directors and writers working in Hollywood today. If we specifically take a closer look at Get Out...
You ever play golf?
Once. A few years ago. I wasn't very good.
Gordon was a professional golfer for years.
Oh, you kidding? Well, I can't quite swing the hips like I used to, though. But I do know Tiger.
Oh, that's great.
Super.
Gordon loves Tiger.
Oh, best I've ever seen, ever. Hands down.
Then us, we can see these like-minded satirical ideas and comments about the portrayal of black people and how interracial relations work in contemporary USA. Even before what we have today, you can add Spike Lee's Bamboozle to the mix of movies meta-commenting on how society views black people.
The network does not want to see Negroes on television unless they are buffoons.
I would even go so far to add Tyler Perry's Madea movies to the list, or the Wayans brothers' Don't Be a Menace to South Central While Drinking Your Juice in the Hood.
Wakanda forever.
Who is this?
Agnes Brown.
I'm a brown too.
No, you're more black.
Y'all here about to break loot now.
I don't want you hanging out in the streets. I want you to finish school. Because without an education, the only kind of work you're going to get is selling drugs, pimping women, or working security for Eddie Murphy.
The TV series Boondocks owes a lot of credit to Coonskin for both being an animated series, largely commenting on black living in America in a satirical way, but also for its connections to the blaxploitation genre.
Tonight, civil unrest explodes in several major American cities. There have been reports of fires, looting, and violence in the streets, all over a fast food promotion gone terribly wrong.
Coonskin has had a small resurrection from being a lost movie to being found, and some reviews started to pop up today, revisiting the movie to see if it's as controversial as it was before. There still seems to be mixed ideas of the movie today, as of when it was released, and much of the criticism aimed at the movie is towards Bakshi's use of racist iconography as his characters. So because of these earlier examples of movies hugely inspired by Coonskin, and because of it now getting a broader release, I feel that talking about and addressing the criticism the movie still faces could be interesting and worthwhile. This could lead to a deeper understanding of modern American satire aimed at Afro-Americans. I also think there's not enough analysis of this movie. When researching, I only found two analyses of it, and one of them was in a comparison with another movie, Song of the South. Both analyses was only a chapter of a book as well, so I feel there's a gaping hole that needs to be filled, and I'm gonna do my best to contribute, not in a major way since this is a pretty short video essay, so I'm pretty limited, but in some way I will contribute to the area. I will point to connections modern movies has with Coonskin, which I can't really read about anywhere else. This contribution will help with the mapping of influences in cinema history. Let's take a look back at older racist iconography. The most obvious one is in the title of the movie, Coon Skin. And Donald Bogle describes a coon character type to be... There are two other subgroups of characters to the coon, but the pure coon is probably the most blatantly and degrading racist stereotype of them all. He was used in slapstick comedy fashion, where the depiction is usually of a lazy thief butchering the English language. The movies How Rastus Got His Turkey and Rastus in Zululand are perfect examples for this character. Other than the coon character, there is the Tom one. And Bogle describes Tom as... Two early versions of Tom appeared in the movies Confederate Spy and For Massa's Sake. The first movie, Tom dies to a firing squad, but he's content because he did it for his master's sake. In the second one, Tom actually sells himself back into slavery to help his master through a rough financial period. Then you have racist female iconography like the Mammy. With these characters explained, let's take a look back at some other time periods. The 1960s was a time of politically charged movies. You had stars like Sidney Poitier playing a policeman in The Heat of the Night, where he is suspected of a local murder in a racially hostile town in Mississippi. Before that, he was in A Raisin in the Sun, playing a part of a poor black family who's about to be evicted. His job of being a chauffeur has him driving rich white clients around, a job that he finds more and more unsatisfying. The latter of these movies is an intricate portrayal of a black family in the inner cities and the problems they are faced with regarding their skin color. Bogle describes the 60s like this. Poitier became the star, maybe the black star, of the 60s, and he became a black icon in Hollywood. He won an Oscar for his character in the movie Lilies of the Field, and his usual character type that he would end up being locked inside of were that of a kind-hearted black man who was also very intelligent. He didn't really have any sexual characteristics and was usually portrayed as asexual. Of course, you can't really say that the time period of the 60s strictly falls under one portrayal of one black actor, but since Poitier was as big as he was during these years, I would say that he plays an important role for the black man during the 60s. If we jump to the 1970s, American cinema was now a part of the new Hollywood. Inside of this historical era was also a new type of black movies, with new types of black characters and stories that differ a lot from the Poitier black man of the 60s. Donald Bogle has this to say about the 70s. The movies reflected this atmosphere described by Donald Bogle, and according to him, no other period in black cinema history has been so important and energetic as the 70s. You had black scriptwriters writing for important productions, you had a lot of working black actors taking more space than they ever did before, you had black directors such as Gordon Parks Sr., Gordon Parks Jr., Ossie Davis and Stan Lathan, to name a few, working on major studio films. For the first time ever, you had these studios specifically producing black-oriented movies, specifically for a black audience. These movies had black characters acting in a new and different way than before, but with this new age of black portrayal in cinema, old stereotypes would take new shapes and forms. Donald Bogle calls this era the age of the buck, and he quickly describes the character of a buck like... This buck character made its first entry in Melvin Van Peebles' Sweet Sweetback's Badass Song.
We just want want to borrow one of your boys for a couple hours and take him downtown to make us look good.
As a titular character, Sweetback. The film centers on this character who is, as Bogle calls him, cool as a cucumber black stud, who smashes white policemen's heads in when he sees another black man being beaten. Now that's how the movie starts, and through some chase sequences and a couple of sexual encounters, the movie ends with Sweetback escaping the law. The movie ends with the message. Now the interesting part with this movie and what it shows is that a black character meets violence with violence and it triumphs over the corrupt white establishment. On top of that, before Sweetback, most black characters were portrayed as asexual or not allowed to be sexually aggressive, but with this character, black audiences could see a black character being more sexually active. Another buck character is Shaft.
Up yours! Get out of the way!
Cats ain't gonna be here, he should be here.
Open it up.
Shaft's his name. Shaft's his game.
And he appears in this movie as a private detective who wears a leather coat and struts up and down Harlem in search of a gangster's daughter. While Shaft works inside of the law or justice in some way, he's in another way free of the white establishment. The movie shows this with the white cops trying to pressure Shaft for information about the case that he's handling, but they can't really push him. He's his own man and nobody can do what Shaft does. He is also not afraid to mingle with both the police and gangsters and mobsters, and he blends these worlds perfectly. This combination of the world and the character not really being a typical hero would become a staple in these new ghetto tales. Another movie that was early with the portrayal of the buck stereotype is Superfly.
This dude is bad, and he ain't just fly. He's Superfly, yeah. Superfly.
This movie differs quite a bit from Shaft because of the profession that the main character Priest has. He's a dope pusher. So the movie's main character is a black cocaine dealer and he's on top of the dope game, but now he wants out. Even though this is a very selfish movie where Priest just wants to take the money and leave, the money he has earned by destroying other people's life, and he has a hand in the urban decay the movie is taking place in. There are still some political points being made that targets the white empowerment of the law. The cops in the movie are all corrupt, and they initially let Priest and his partner deal coke if some of the proceeds goes to them. In the end, Priest leaves the game and he triumphs over the police that wish to force him to work for them. Even though this movie was a hit, some people within the Afro-American community despised the film for the movie's hero. Other movies than Shaft and Superfly where this character type could be found includes Black Caesar, Slaughter, Blackula, and The Mac, to name a few. To problematize this character type and movie, we need to look at who's behind all these productions. Because the look and advertising of these movies were made to look black, but most often than not, they weren't really. Most of these movies were instead produced, directed, and written by white people for the sake of making money on black people, by exploiting the audience's needs. Hence, the name of blaxploitation. Bogle defines this sort of movie as blaxploitation film. A movie that played on the needs of black audiences for heroic figures without answering those needs in realistic terms. Junius Griffin of the Hollywood branch of the NAACP criticized these portrayals of black life by saying, "I think it's important to note that the NAACP, the National Advancement for Colored People, is a heavy hitter inside of the black press. They've been around since 1909 and they're one of the biggest institutions when it comes to advocating for equal rights in America. So their voice always matters when it comes to black portrayal." Many of these buck characters were loved because of the way they acted towards everything around them. They emitted some sort of extreme self-confidence that made them able to fight back against the corrupt cops or dope pushers. This confidence made these characters able to do who they were, and this sent out hope to the black audiences who went and saw these stories and characters. They could control the chaotic and corrupt world around them.
"Hey, where the hell you going, Shaft?
To get laid. Where the hell you going?
That boy's got a lot of mouth on him."
To connect Coonskin with blaxploitation, we can identify the environment both movie and genre takes place in. Harlem, ghetto-fied.
"Fuck you.
All right, I'm going to give you a little example.
I heard that 350 of you white folks committed suicide by jumping off of the Golden Gate Bridge. And out of the 350, there was only two that was niggers.
And one of them was pushed."
The focus on urban decay is center, and inside of this decay, you have the typical characters of pimps, pushers, and prostitutes. Other more active characters are the mafia, and especially the white corrupt cops that the movie paints as the villain.
Oh, Sheriff, good idea, Yearn, finishing off Saturday night with a little black horn.
Yeah. Only thing this nigger's town got to offer is cheap booze and some women.
Coonskin also uses a lot of the more taboo areas where exploitation movies like to go, such as sex, violence, and drugs. The color and aesthetic of the movie's pictures are in exploitation fashion as well, looking very lo-fi and gritty. The overt racist character depictions could be seen as an attack on all the whites behind the black movies of the era. Bakshi could be using his whiteness to poke fun of the problem behind all these other productions in a sort of "this is what whites think of blacks" by painting the black characters in such an extreme way. Julius Griffin problematized the new black stereotypes and that black kids are being fed this new image of blackness. So the whites behind these productions helped to create this new racist stereotype by depicting black bodies as the movies does. It is also important to note that Coonskin has a black revolutionary spirit that the blaxploitation movies don't. This is why it's important for us to look further at Coonskin later. If we switch our view over to something else than blaxploitation, to a company that built its legacy on pictures of racist iconography. Disney re-released their classic Song of the South in 1972, and for the next 15 years it was played back and fro until 1986. The movie is a collection of the Uncle Remus stories that include Br'er Rabbit, Br'er Bear, and Br'er Fox. It blends two stories together. The main story is about a young white boy who lives with his mother on a Georgian plantation, and he meets Uncle Remus, who tells the stories that transformed the movie to an animation with three animal characters. It's basically Uncle Remus teaching the young white boy important life lessons. When Ralph Bakshi made Coonskin, he stated, "Coonskin is a satire on Song of the South, and it uses blaxploitation elements to highlight this. Bakshi transformed the three innocent Disney characters,
and Br'er Fox, he lay low.
Oh, I hope he do. I sure hope he do.
Br'er Rabbit, now it's up to him to teach the stuck-up strangers some manners. And he said,
look, if you don't say hi the time I count three, I'm gonna bust you wide open."
Into books, straight from a blaxploitation picture, and the idea that instead of the backdrop being the new South, it is now Harlem.
"Which one of you fine Southern gentlemen is next?"
"Marigold."
"Daddy?"
"God damn, Rabbit, I should have known better. Mess you done got us all into."
Black people are still impoverished, and not as much has changed from the plantation days. Black people are slaves to other kinds of forces, whether it be drugs, the police, or Miss America. Coonskin was first screened in 1974 as a work in progress at MoMA, and the screening was interrupted by protesters from Congress of Racial Equality. Elaine Parker, the chairman of CORE, had this to say about the movie. "Apart from CORE, other members and organizations of the black press protested the movie and its release. The black actors in the movie, Scatman Crothers, Barry White, and Philip Michael Thomas, were branded as traitors to the race. In 1975, the movie underwent a lot of edits and dialogue replacements. Thanks to this, it continuously pushed the release date, and when it eventually was released in August 1975, it was met with bomb threats and smoke bomb incidents at some theaters. The movie was basically dismissed by critics, and it totally bombed at the box office. After 2 weeks of playing at theaters, it was pulled out. So what is the movie about? What made it so difficult to watch?" The movie is really about two stories inside of one movie, like Song of the South. It blends reality with animation to sort of distinguish each story from the other. The story that's set in reality is Philip Michael Thomas and Scatman Crothers are going to break out of jail. They are now waiting for the getaway vehicle to come to their rescue. While they wait, Crothers tells Michael Thomas about three characters.
"I used to know three guys.
just like you and your friends. That was Brother Rabbit.
As smart as you are, he was. And as mean as you is, he is. Brother Bear, as big as he was, that's how strong he was. That Preacher Fox, as wild as he was, that's how wild he was.
This is where the movie becomes animation, so we are transported into the world of animation now, and the story switches back and forth. Brother Rabbit needs to get away from the American South, and together with Preacher Fox and Brother Bear, they make their way to
Harlem.
While in Harlem, they stumble upon all kinds of characters, but the most prevalent ones are the Italian mafioso together with the racist corrupt cop, who controls the drug trade. Now, Brother Rabbit wants to destroy the drug rule of the mafia in Harlem. Inside of this basic outline of a story is where much of the interesting subtext takes place. The movie, inside of the animation part, switches from different perspectives, and a lot of random characters we stumble upon are crucial to understanding what the movie wants to say. So what will I be analyzing in Coonskin? I will first identify the racist iconography that appears in the movie. I won't be identifying everything since I don't have the time, but a good portion of some of the most crucial scenes. After identifying, I will analyze what Bakshi says with and does with the icons. How does he use them? What meaning do they carry? Important to note is that the meaning I analyze in the movie might not be Bakshi's meaning or intention. This is my reading of his movie. I don't know if I read the scenes as he wants people to read them, so it's important to point out that this is my reading of scenes with the help of other texts I've used to create my own meaning of what's going on. Ralph Bakshi stated in a quote, "The film speaks for itself, which is what films are supposed to do." I wasn't lying. A male told some truths that were unpleasant, but I never lied. While you can of course dispute the fact about what is true with the movie, like Core did on its release, maybe it's easier now to see and pick apart the movie and all its details. I want to hone in on a specific scene, an intermission, that captures a lot in its small screen time, and it doesn't really have anything to do with the movie's story, but more with the overarching story and message it's trying to push. Let's watch the first part of this.
Y'all remember when we used to run and fight for that empty white apartment? Shit, this nigga be sitting at home, heard that some white folks was moving out 10 blocks away, and I'd run like a hurricane to get there first. By the time this sucker would get there, there would be 3 million brothers jumping all over the fire escapes, and 3 million more Jews packing and running the other way. Shit, we all got apartments. We got the whole neighborhood, man. Shit.
The character talking could be identified as the typical coon character, as Bogle helped us to describe, by his shoddy clothing, bare feet, and his loud and comedic antics on display. Behind him, we have a barbershop with singing black people, but it switches back and forth between shots of the movie Birth of a Nation by W. Griffith. If you have seen this movie, you know the controversial nature of it and its portrayal of black people as villains and the Ku Klux Klan as heroes. By putting the coon character on top of a screen showing Birth of a Nation and cutting back and forth between a barbershop links these two different times and movies to each other, linking the character back to early beginnings of black visuality in American cinema. The Birth of a Nation screen represents an early time for cinema and pictures of black people, and it's no surprise that Bakshi picks that movie since it's such a cornerstone in American cinema, pioneering early techniques while telling the great saga of the American nation. Inside all of this, you have the horrible portrayal of black people being portrayed as evil, sadistic brutes that rape white women. Important to say about Birth of a Nation is that the Ku Klux Klan had a resurgence thanks to it, telling us what power movies wield. The barbershop backdrop serves as a transportation to another time setting, with another type of portrayal of black people. From there to here, sort of. The coon tells us about white folks moving out and black people moving in, dancing on the fire escapes. "We had the whole neighborhood, man," he shouts, and then points his finger in a fuck you kind of way. He's talking about ghettos or black neighborhoods like Harlem, where the movie Coonskin is taking place. He's also talking about a community, the community of black people, that forms inside of this neighborhood, and what happens after is a tear, a transformation, It's a transformation from the coon to something else. The icon of the coon was created by whites, as Bogle explained it earlier, and it's a picture of black people that's been stuck and nailed to the skin of them. Again and again, this white idea of what a black person is or should be, we can see if we gaze back in cinema history, from Birth of a Nation to a Poitier's mild-mannered intelligence and gentleman-like black portrayal, to the 70s bucks with loaded guns and militant action. This idea of what black is, created by whites, can be traced to even after Coonskin, to the 80s and onwards. Again, think of whom it was that made blaxploitation movies. Who was it that wrote the characters and the stories, and then sold it to the black audiences? The white directors and scriptwriters? What happens in this transformation is the shedding of skin, coon skin. The coon transforms into something new and fresh, something revolutionary. This could be a call to action by Bakshi, saying that black people need to rise up and throw away the earlier skin that was given to them by white people. Or he could be saying that it's already taking place right now. Moving onwards with the next sequence. This character could be identified as a mammy character by her sex, clothing, but also her body type. It's typical mammy fashion, as Bogle points out earlier to us. This shares the same rebellious nature that the former scene had with a racist icon trying to break free from its shackles. The mammy chases the pancake with a revolver, clearly displaying another nature than what a mammy tends to have. Why it's a pancake could be because of the connection the mammy has with the kitchen and foods. Usually, the mammy character bakes or cooks food. Her place is in the kitchen. The pancake is a representation of that room, but now the mammy is chasing the pancake around with a revolver, firing until she can stomp the pancake to a mush. The mammy is basically revolting against her former position inside of the kitchen and her relationship with the food. The relationship this scene shares with the former is the same revolting spirit. These icons must evolve, and so must black people. It's a picture tearing at its seams, trying to establish a new meaning. The last piece of this segment is the song that plays in the beginning. I'm a minstrel man, I'm the cleaning man, I'm the pole man, I'm a shoeshine man, I'm a nigger man. Watch me dance. But it is now recited by the coon character from the first scene in the intermission segment.
I'm the minstrel man, the cleaning man, the pole man, the shoeshine man, I'm a nigger man, watch me dance. Yeah, I got the devil in me. Been waiting on welfare line, unemployment line, gas line since 9. Now I'm waiting on the pawn shop line. Hey, I got the devil in me. Been shot on, pushed on, gassed on, passed on, red, white, and blue on. Now I'm waiting to turn on. Hey, I got the devil in me. It's the man you see. I'm a natural black face, and up my sleeve I'm holding an ace that I won't die in disgrace. If I stop dancing and don't let you blow me any more in the wind, 'cause I refuse to come.
Help! Rape! Rape!
To start off, it's interesting to compare this song with the Song of the South. Disney movies always has a recurring song that tends to be more positive in nature and forget your troubles. Song of the South has very much of both this melodically but also story-wise.
Zippity-doo-dah, zippity-yay, Mr. Bluebird's on my shoulder.
Coonskin imitates this idea for a song, but it's not really recurring except for the intro and then this segment. However, it is hard to exclude the fact that Coonskin is a blaxploitation imitation of Song of the South, so the songs needs to be compared. Coonskin's song was written by Bakshi and performed by Scatman Crothers, and it's a cynical portrayal of black people and their relationship with white America. The song is also in the blues genre, connecting it more to black people due to the history of blues, growing out of black plantation workers' worker songs. In the lyrics, there are different interesting lines to point out. The beginning of the song has lyrics saying,
I'm the minstrel man, the cleaning man, the pole man, the shoe shine man, I'm a nigger man, watch me dance.
Which connotes these different jobs to black people, these jobs that Bakshi means are deeply connected to the black identity. The song is a portrayal, and here it is building a character. The black man is the minstrel man, he is the shoe shine man. The last part of the lyrics, where he is saying, watch me dance.
Watch me dance!
Is a reference to the old minstrel shows that were largely held in the South, and once again Bakshi's pointing out the satire in the nostalgia that Song of the South seems to be evoking of the old Dixie days of the New South. The character of the coon is deeply connected with these minstrel shows, but Watch Me Dance could also mean that the black man is still here to entertain the white folks, since white America is watching him perform. He is making a buffoon of himself for white America's sake. The song continues with these building blocks of the black man, where he's saying,
been waiting on welfare line, unemployment line, gas line since 9. Now I'm waiting on the pawn shop line.
A dark portrayal of black people, but in the words of Bakshi, truth. Black people are low income, underemployed, and thieves, according to Bakshi's song, and then it takes an even darker turn.
Been shot on, pushed on, gassed on, passed on, red, white, and blue on. Now I'm waiting to turn on.
I've been pushed on, gassed on, and so on are all terms for being kicked around, and Tommy's saying here that he's about to turn on, meaning to turn on the system, the whites. Like the other scene, here is another phrase that's alluding to revolution because of the way he has been treated. In the end of the song, he looks at Miss America and says,
if I stop dancing and don't let you blow me any more in the wind, 'cause I refuse to come.
Help! Rape! Rape!
If I stop dancing and don't let you blow me in the wind because I refuse to come, while looking directly at Miss America, this is a threat to white America. If the black man stops dancing and instead turns on the establishment, what will happen then? What happens when black people historically have taken to the streets and wanted change? Bakshi is very critical here of what the results will be if the black man stops entertaining the white America and demands respect. It's absolutely debatable if Bakshi's cynical view of a black revolution has always led to more violence and no change, but in this segment he wants to allude back to the old southern days of Jim Crow. The reference to the lynching of black people are ultra clear, with the white woman yelling rape while no rape has ever taken place. Miss America is another interesting character that shows up in a couple of other scenes, and I want to show two of them.
Hey, honey, it has been good for us. I mean, meaning us. See, our relationship has increased a tonfold these here few years. And I'm so happy and lucky to feel that we is finally getting it together. And you know where I'm coming from? So how about Miss America coming over to my place and letting me squeeze your tits? I should have fucked her when I had the chance.
This is a metaphor where the black character is supposed to play the part of black people as a whole in America, and the white buxom lady painted in red, white, and blue is America, Miss America. The black man is tenderly kissing the arm of America, asking her for sex, since their relationship has been pretty good lately. This could be read as a wish to unite into one, but Miss America seems to feel that the black man is coming off a little too greedy, so she punches and kicks the black man down in the streets. It's an interesting portrayal of race relations in America done in a humorous way, but with a very serious and unfunny theme of discussion. It's also done in typical exploitation way, with America being portrayed as a busty young blonde acting violently towards the black man, even throwing a fire post on top of him. This discussion of race relations will be continued in the next scene with her.
Okay. Okay, you red, white, and blue. Now you no good, Miss America! How you like this shit?
Okay, you win.
Huh? I win? I won?
Okay, yeah, boy.
Hey, put down your gun. You won. You can take me. Come on, fella.
Oh, she got the clap.
This scene is an escalation from the former scene, where the black man is now militant instead of being more civil. Before, he asked, this time he's gonna take, with the help of violence. This can be read as a straight reference to the more aggressive civil rights protests from Malcolm X or Black Panthers, where violence was encouraged. Miss America tricks the black man after she surrenders to the violence, but then shoots him with a hidden gun. Once again, the black man's struggle to unite with America is on display. What can be criticized of these short segments is their portrayal of black people. Was it really a smart way to make the black man horny and aggressive towards the woman? Is it really an effective way of highlighting a serious problem by creating the scene in this way, with this dilemma of sex acting as a metaphor for unity? Well, it's definitely debatable. This next scene shows race relations in a specific setting, a fancy restaurant.
You know, it was really nice to meet you. You really look terrific, doesn't she? And you know, not only do you look terrific, but you dance terrifically. I mean, Herbert thinks you dance terrifically, but...
Yes, you dance terrifically.
He's too embarrassed. Well, you know, the funny thing is that we've always talked about having black people.
Yes, it's
club.
Finally, it's very nice to have...
But I mean, now that you're really here and everything, it's just
club.
Incredible, isn't it? I mean, tell her.
Yes, it's incredible.
It's so great, and the things you're wearing and everything and all the colors. I mean, we always have to wear the same old things.
Yeah,
our
time
parents
after time, it's
like
the
that.
Same old thing.
And we always complain about how we'd like to be different, but you guys really do it, you know? I mean, don't
yeah.
they?
No, they've done it. Yeah, you've done it. Yes, it's different.
The white woman is very shippy and may not realize how she is exotifying black people by the things she's saying. The white woman acts like she has never seen another black person before, but she's so glad that she finally can meet the other part of America. She highlights different topics where she feels different, dances, clothes, and colors. This scene is excellent satire on the white liberal kind that likes to see themselves as very inclusionary, while they appear to be more exclusionary by exotifying the people they try to include. The white husband, however, seems to bear another attitude. Through gritted teeth, he agrees with his wife. It might be that he sees what she is doing and is annoyed by it, or it could be that he's annoyed by the black people's presence inside of the fancy restaurant. Another piece of satire of how black people sometimes literally have to fight their way out of poverty by becoming a boxer or some other athlete.
Bear became a boxer for the mafia and learned to beat up on his brother.
The boxing profession is a specifically interesting one, since it has to do with beating your opponent until he or she collapses. Your opponent tends to be another black, and guess who's watching? The white establishment. This harkens back to the gladiator scenes taking place in ancient Colosseum, where slaves would fight for the oppressor's entertainment. The same goes to show here, and the movie pokes fun at this. Coonskin uses racist iconography for both its satire purpose, but also to highlight the complicated and racist past that is still so prevalent in American movies. This is Bakshi's defense against coarse lambasting of the movie, and he's not alone in defense for his film. NAACP had this to say. Actor Philip Michael Thomas that's in the movie said this. These stereotyped images that Bakshi talk about are of course easy to spot in the movie, but the interesting part is not his explanation of them, it's him turning them inside out and trying to destroy them that's interesting. As I pointed out in my analysis of the intermission segment, it's a segment that works against established racist iconography to showcase how these old stereotypes still live inside of the visual culture and to promote change within the black portrayal by liberating the black man from the coonskin. While the movie has segments that can offer a chuckle or two, it's not at all a funny movie, but instead a very serious portrayal of black Harlem and black people during the 70s. It is debatable if doing a cartoon about the black experience is the best way to make serious statements about poverty-stricken black people. On the other hand, you can point out that it needs to be a cartoon for Bakshi because of his satire towards Disney and Song of the South, but also so he can do the extreme caricatures that he wanted. It's easy, however, to spot the problems Core had with the movie's portrayal of black people in the 70s, and it's easy to see it 50 years later and say, of course it's satire. Even if it is satire, it still uses racist iconography animated by a white man, and I can't understand why people would feel uncomfortable with that, and Bakshi telling a black story about black people. What does he know about the black experience? As Robert Stamm and Ella Showet says in their book, On Thinking Eurocentrism, Multiculturalism and Media. I find this quote to be interesting to apply to Coonskin and its creator. When looking for other opinions on the movie, I used the movie forum Letterboxd to see what people thought about the movie. The overall score is pretty high, but those that didn't like the movie always had the same problem with it, and it had to do with the white identity of the director. What I can gather, the problem is that a white tells a black story, and he shouldn't be allowed to use the racist stereotypes. This is an interesting point to delve deeper into another time, but connecting these reviews with Showhat and Stamm's quote points to something that's complex. Can other identities talk about other identities in a comedic, satirical way without being racist or insensitive? Who decides what's insensitive? It's an interesting thought to keep in mind when discussing the movie. Using the racist iconography might also backfire and be used by anti-black groups as ammunition for their propaganda. The movie falls into a tricky situation due to the pictures and narrative. This is what makes it so interesting to dissect. Racist iconography changes and morphs with the time. The character of a coon might take on a different disguise today. Earlier in the video, I talked about modern movies that have been inspired by Coonskin in their racial satire, and I hope it's clear now how and where they have been inspired. You can see Coonskin's restaurant scenes in Peele's Get Out dinner party scene. In Us, you can see Peele playing with the portrayal of the big black father as a gorilla, or the small black boy as a chimp, a racist caricature that it picks apart just like how Coonskin picks apart other racist iconography. I hope with this video essay to have shed some light on a still pretty underground movie that was and still is being debated today.
Steady, are you ready? What's going on? Steady, are you ready?
Are you ready?
What's going on?
What's going on?
Cold, fresh air. Feel the melody that's in the air. I'm down, take a look around. What's going down?
Hi, buddy, I want me.